Fire damaged the Karpeles Manuscript Library Museum, leading a lot of people to say, the what? Our story on the man who opened museums like this across the country and why it was so important to save the kinds of things inside. Here's something else we might not have been aware of.
St. Louis has really kind of become a capital of storytelling in the United States.
We can find out why at the upcoming 40th St. Louis Storytelling Festival. And the rain didn't keep the crowds away 77 years ago. They wanted to see one of the country's first heroes of World War II. This was the day Butch O'Hare came home. It's all next on Living St. Louis. I'm Jim Kircher, and we don't generally cover fires. We leave that to the other guys. But in this case, we make an exception because the fire here was at one of St. Louis's more unusual museums. In fact, the Karpeles Museum is so unusual that when it first opened, we came to find out just what it was all about. Fortunately, the fire, as big as it was, did not destroy what was inside. That's important because, as Ruthie Zell found out when we came here, a lot of that stuff could never have been replaced.
The sign's been installed. The walls have been repaired and painted. And the packages opened and unpacked. The newest Karpeles Manuscript Library Museum, in a chain of such institutions across the country, opened its doors in St. Louis in August of 2015. And while a manuscript museum might not have you jumping out of your chair, this one holds some pretty interesting remnants of history, including St. Louis history. Housed in the historic former Christian Science Church on Russell Boulevard across from Compton Hill Reservoir Park, the museum joins a dozen other Karpeles museums in mid-sized U.S. cities, including Buffalo, New York, Jacksonville, Florida, Shreveport, Louisiana, and Alvin, Texas. St. Louis native Carrie Manderbach is director of the St. Louis branch.
At current time, there are 13. St. Louis is lucky number 13.
The items displayed at the museums are from the private collection of mathematician turned real estate investor David Karpeles, founder and CEO of the museums. The 80-year-old native Californian holds a doctorate in history. But ironically, this lover of ancient ephemera began his career in the high-tech computer world.
He's reputed to have developed the first optical text recognition software.
A family trip in the 1970s spurred him to begin collecting at auction and from other collectors.
He and his family were on a cultural outing, and they ended up at a museum that had some manuscripts, including some by Benjamin Franklin. And at first, his children were a little bored by some of it. And then his son happened to notice that Benjamin Franklin's writing mimicked his own handwriting. And he said, "Dad, look, my handwriting looks like Benjamin Franklin's." And so his son sort of got a connection through that to this historical figure. And it made Dr. Karpeles think about collecting manuscripts himself.
Since then, Karpeles has amassed the world's largest private holding of important original documents and manuscripts, with more than 1 million items.
He has things like the first page of the draft of the Confederate Constitution. He has Babe Ruth's first contract with the Yankees. He has the draft of Abraham Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation, and of course the Wright brothers.
Local history is well represented in the collection, including the St. Louis Athletic Association's application to baseball's National League, Charles Lindbergh's certificate of landing following his transatlantic flight in the Spirit of St. Louis, and the Great Soulard Discovery Map, a copy of which was used by Lewis and Clark on their expedition west.
The first museum opened back in the 1980s, and that opened in Santa Barbara, California. And then from that point, Dr. Karpeles bought other unused buildings, and he renovated these buildings, and he created a space where he could display the manuscripts he was collecting.
The museum system allows the manuscripts to circulate throughout the country.
And all those things get rotated in from other museums, and we rotate them back out at the end of every quarter. Dr. Karpeles has such an amazing collection of manuscripts that we can go for years without having to repeat the same thing twice.
The items in the collection are boxed and shipped from museum to museum and displayed in ultraviolet-proof cases with gauges that monitor humidity levels. For items that are too fragile to travel, a reproduction is sent. The Karpeles Museum purchased the St. Louis building in January 2015 and spent more than $300,000 in repairs and renovations. The building itself is a work of art. Opened in 1911, it was designed by St. Louis architect Albert B. Groves, who also designed the St. Louis City Hall Rotunda. It has a sanctuary on the second level that will remain intact for museum functions and rentals. It even has a kitchen and full-size turquoise green baptismal pool in the basement, left from the days when the building served as a Baptist church.
A curator said to them, well, while you're here, why don't you go visit the library?
Jean Wasco was one of the museum's first volunteers. Her Ph.D. in Victorian literature and her background as a grant writer for the St. Louis History Museum made it a good fit. She recognizes both the challenges and benefits of a manuscript museum.
I don't think children connect with handwriting anymore and with handwritten documents. And it's because they don't write. But you can't have any of the advanced knowledges we have unless people are writing things down. So the written word is always changing in some ways, and we'll get over this hump, but it's really nice to take the step backward and to remember that whole process of communication.
The Karpeles collection isn't the only thing housed at the museum. A small room off its main exhibition space hosts the St. Louis Media Archives. Rotating exhibits feature memorabilia from St. Louis's rich media history in radio, television, print, advertising, and public relations.
The St. Louis Media History Foundation was established to acquire and preserve St. Louis media history so that we don't lose this stuff. Our collection is beyond anything I'd ever imagined. For the most part, we've gone out and found it. I was literally in dumpsters pulling stuff out. Everyone is touched by media. We are trying to do exactly what Dr. Karpeles is doing, to remind people of what came before.
Manderbach agrees.
Historical figures are people that you read about in history books, and you really don't have a connection to them. But with the manuscripts, they're sort of like footsteps in history. I myself am very fascinated by all this, and I think the majority of St. Louisans will be too.
The fire in late March caused extensive damage, but it was primarily to the roof and the second floor. The manuscripts, the artifacts, those were saved. And the building probably could be rebuilt, but no decision's been announced regarding the future of this museum. We like telling stories on Living St. Louis, and we've been doing it for a while, but nothing compared to the St. Louis Storytelling Festival, which is now in its 40th year. And they don't just bring storytellers to the stage, they bring great stories to the community.
The festival runs from April 25th to May 4th, and there are some 90 different events in all kinds of venues throughout the area. When it comes to storytelling festivals, this is a big deal.
St. Louis has really kind of become a capital of storytelling in the United States.
But storytellers around the country might well be more aware of St. Louis than St. Louis is of them or their own festival. Lisa Overholser has been festival director for 5 years.
I'm very familiar with that phrase. I've never heard of that before. Yeah. But yeah, we've been around for 40 years.
The festival's run by the University of Missouri's Extension Office, and it started out with the Gateway Arch as its partner, and it still is. The first festival was small, with a small mention in the paper, but it turns out they were in on the ground floor of something of a storytelling revival.
This was coming right after the bicentennial celebrations in the United States, so that kind of idea of who are we and, you know, where are we and who are we as a country and, you know, what's our story? So that was kind of in circulation at the time, and there was kind of a storytelling renaissance at the time. So all of those kind of came together to create the first storytelling festival here in St. Louis.
Well, you must be doing something right, because you've been doing it now for 40 years. I don't mean you personally, but this has been going on for 40 years. Or what is working well in this for it to be able to keep going like this?
Yeah, storytelling is, you know, it's a very old art form. It's a very traditional art form. It's one of the most kind of basic ways to express oneself. And it exists in all cultures. It exists all over the world. And it's just a very resilient way that cultures have sustained themselves. So I think over the course of the 40 years, it's changed a lot. Storytelling has really gone through some major shifts. But it's been resilient, it's, you know, persevered, and storytellers have adapted. It's grown into this really fantastic kind of professional art form also over the past 40 years, and that's been really exciting to see.
I know you have a lot of events in a lot of different places, so if I want to go, I can go there, but you're also, I think over the years, the festival has made an effort to bring it to the community as opposed to bring the community to the festival.
Yes, yes. When we started 40 years ago, it was a two-day festival, and we were primarily at the Arch. We did go into schools already that first year, and that's always been kind of a core of our festival, is working with schools and integrating into school curriculum, and that has remained a core. Over the years, due to many different changes, more and more we've been engaging with community partners and, you know, working with their programming, going to their sites, working with their audiences, and kind of integrating into the work that they already do. So the festival is very much a community-based effort. It has been that way since the beginning. But this year, as an example, we have over 90 different sites. Now, a lot of those are schools. Some of those are not open to the public. We go into the children's hospital. We go, you know, into the city juvenile detention center. We go into a lot of schools, and those are not going to be open to the public. But we have a lot of public events as well that are going to be very public, at performance venues, at parks, at, you know, historic sites and museums and things like that. So it's a really interesting festival, very community-based.
Is the target audience generally kids or families? Are there some things which may not be family-friendly, more adult-oriented?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because working with K through 12 curriculum and youth has always been kind of a core of our festival. But storytelling, a lot of storytelling, you know, is very much for adult audiences. And not that it's, you know, crude or vulgar or anything like that. It's just, you know, the themes are a little bit, they need a little bit more time to digest. They may be more mature themes. So we have events for all ages. We have events for as young as pre-K, but we also have events for retired audiences, for adults. We have some of our evening programs, our later tale programs, specifically for adult audiences. You know, we have a deaf storyteller that's going to be working with the deaf community here in St. Louis. That's always been a long-time partner of ours, is the deaf community. So we work with a lot of different community organizations and kind of cater to, you know, who their audiences are as well. And it could be very young children, it could be older children, it could be families, you know, encouraging that kind of communal experience of storytelling.
This is something that a lot of people feel we've lost and we need more of. So they might be looking at what you do and say, this is great, because this we need this more than ever.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. If you talk to any of our featured storytellers or any professional storyteller, they'll tell you that one of the skills you need to have as a storyteller, ironically, is the ability to listen. And that's another aspect that I think storytelling really emphasizes, because that connection, there has to be a storyteller, but there has to be a listener. And being a good storyteller is as much about telling the story as it is about listening. And that's always going to be a skill that, you know, we're going to need, and we need to preserve, and we need to really not forget that we need that in our society. And we need to be able to articulate well and to pass information along articulately and expressively and artfully. And that's never going to change. We're always, as humans, going to be doing that.
And they'll be doing that all over St. Louis as part of the Storytelling Festival kicking off on April 25th.
Finally, we're going to go back 77 years to a rainy Saturday in April. Despite the weather, crowds lined the streets of downtown St. Louis and gathered here at Soldiers Memorial. They were welcoming home Navy fighter pilot Butch O'Hare. Now, his name has long been attached to Chicago's airport. But Butch O'Hare's story is really a St. Louis story. And 77 years ago, everybody here knew that.
It was April 24th of 1942, just a little over 4 months since the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor. And America needed a man like Butch O'Hare, and St. Louis couldn't be prouder. In the South Pacific, his heroics, in the face of overwhelming odds, had earned him the Congressional Medal of Honor. The Navy brought him home to boost morale, and now he was back for a brief visit to his hometown. Back again among family and friends who probably never really expected greatness from the likable kid they knew as Eddie. Popular, he was. Promising, not so much. Eddie O'Hare was born in 1914. He wouldn't be called Butch until much later. He was the oldest, followed by two sisters, Patsy and Marilyn. As kids, they lived above a grocery store in Soulard. Their parents were typical of a lot of St. Louis couples. Their mother, Selma, Southside German. Their father, E.J., Northside Irish, the son of Patty O'Hare, who ran a restaurant at 4th and Delmar, then still called Morgan Street. E.J. O'Hare grew up to become a hard-working, ambitious man who, as an adult, put himself through law school and got into the business of running dog and horse racing tracks in the Metro East, Chicago, and Florida, a job that meant working with Al Capone's organization. And E.J. would be the first in the family whose death would make front-page news. But at this time, he was a wealthy, well-connected businessman. And his son, Eddie, seemed to be nothing like him. Eddie O'Hare liked to avoid hard work. What he did like was cars, which he was already driving, and food. When Eddie was 13, his father decided what his undisciplined son needed was military school. Butch O'Hare was enrolled at Western Military Academy in Alton, Illinois in 1927 when he was 13 years old, and spent 5 years there from 8th grade through the end of high school. The first few years were tough, but he would improve as a student and as a cadet. He would see his family on some weekends, and he would be home in St. Louis for summers and holidays. In 1930, the O'Hares bought a new home in the Southside Holly Hills neighborhood. Just another modest house until E.J. put in a swimming pool. It was unusual for anyone to have an in-ground pool or, in these times, a camera for taking home movies. The O'Hares had money, and the pool made the new house the center of neighborhood activity. His parents had gotten divorced, and E.J. was now living in Chicago, but still involved with his children. There is a story that he helped Eddie get into the Naval Academy by offering information to the feds about Capone, but that's speculation. It's never been documented. Still, Eddie got the appointment.
A lot of people pick up nicknames at Annapolis, and this is where Eddie O'Hare came to be called Butch. The whole family came from St. Louis for the graduation, and E.J. came in from Chicago. He would never live to see his son become a hero. 2 years later, in 1939, E.J. O'Hare was gunned down by the mob. At the time of his father's death, Butch had been finishing his pilot training, and World War II was already underway in Europe. Butch was assigned to the aircraft carrier USS Saratoga. and he was under the command of the legendary Jimmy Thatch. Thatch had recognized Butch O'Hare as one of his top pilots. His unique combination of personal, physical, and mental attributes were perfectly suited for this job. Butch O'Hare, who had never really stood out before, had found his calling. That might have surprised his friends back in South St. Louis, but as it turns out, Butch was full of surprises. In September of 1941, he married Rita Wooster, a nurse he had met that summer in St. Louis. She wasn't part of the old gang. A few years before, Butch had broken up with his longtime girlfriend with no real explanation. He asked Rita to marry him the day he met her. And 6 weeks later, the wedding was held in Phoenix, Arizona, where Butch's sister Patsy was living. There were a lot of quick romances and short engagements in these days when it seemed certain that America would soon be at war. As it turned out, it would be just 3 months later when Japan launched the attack on Pearl Harbor. As devastating as it was, it could have been worse. But all three of the Pacific Fleet aircraft carriers were not at Pearl Harbor on December 7th. Butch was in California and shipped out the next day. His air group was transferred to the USS Lexington, and by early 1942, it was heading into the South Pacific to take on the Japanese. On February 22nd, Japanese bombers were spotted approaching the American ships, and a group of fighters went up to meet them. But there was a second wave of bombers, and only Butch and the pilot of another plane were in a position to intercept them, and the other plane's guns jammed. Butch O'Hare was alone, and he went on the attack, 1 against 8. O'Hare would need all his skills.
The fighter plane is limited in how much ammunition it can carry. I know when I was flight training and teaching in Pensacola, one of the things we tried to teach the in gunnery was that you, when you got on a target, you just fired a short burst. But many of the people, and even when they were shooting at targets in Pensacola, would get so, the adrenaline would flow, and they just sit on the trigger. And if they did that, they'd run out of ammunition. But that's the way he was able to do that.
By the time he did run out of ammunition, he had shot down 5 bombers and damaged a 6th. Only 2 got through, and their bombs missed the Lexington. It is still considered one of the greatest feats by a single pilot in air-to-air combat. And it was one of the first pieces of good news of the war. And the Navy decided to bring Butch home to help boost morale. O'Hare was brought to Washington, D.C., where he was promoted to lieutenant commander. He was brought to the White House, where President Franklin Roosevelt awarded him the Medal of Honor. And of course, there were interviews. Asked what it was like again and again in battle, he made it sound like it was all in a day's work.
Well, you worry about how it's going to be after your first approach on them, and you get in and get out safely. Why, it's not so bad on the second one. First one, you're sitting there and you just wonder what it's going to be like.
Well, after you got back to carrier, then how do you feel?
Just terribly excited, or
well, you're
washed out and exhausted, or what? You're very excited and you're ready to go back up again.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
You don't feel a terrific letdown?
No, the letdown comes several hours later.
St. Louis City officials were working hard to bring Butch home, and the Navy would agree to send him to St. Louis, where he would be given his only parade. By all accounts, he would have been happy without one. But this, too, he knew, was now part of the job. It was raining when they arrived at Soldiers Memorial. Butch received the key to the city from Mayor Becker. And then he gave a short speech. He was officially here to present St. Louis with a pennant with the Navy E for Excellence for its efforts in raising money for the Navy Relief Fund. And as the band played Anchors Away, the pennant was raised. Only later that evening was Butch finally able to relax.
He wasn't comfortable with all the attention. He was anxious to get back into the fight.
It was November of 1943. Butch was on the USS Enterprise and was put in charge of developing tactics to defend against nighttime bombing attacks. Butch's pilots, nicknamed the Black Panthers, carried out the very first successful night combat mission by carrier-based planes. But the second time they went out, Butch O'Hare didn't come back. In a battle with Japanese bombers, O'Hare's plane went down. There was an extensive search, but Butch O'Hare was never found. In St. Louis, there would be efforts to name something in honor of Butch O'Hare, a school or a bridge. But his mother always resisted. She said all the young men of the war had been heroes. So it was Chicago in 1949 that put O'Hare's name on its new airport of the future. Memorials exist to remind us that there was a man named Lieutenant Commander Edward O'Hare who was a hero, a naval officer who gave his life in service to his country. But it is perhaps just as important to think of him as the young man called Butch, and of the boy they called Eddie. He became a hero in just a few minutes out of his life when he shot down 5 planes and probably saved thousands of lives. But those few minutes came at a crucial time for America. Just months after Pearl Harbor, Americans needed to know that the enemy that had struck so powerfully and quickly could be faced, battled, and beaten. And Butch O'Hare had done it single-handedly. When he came home, that's what people really needed to know.
And that's Living St. Louis. Thanks for joining us. I'm Jim Kircher, and we'll see you next time.
Living St. Louis is made possible by the support of the Mary Rankin Jordan and Eddie A. Jordan Charitable Foundation and by the members of Nine Networks.